Oh, can we just stand and worship Jesus this morning? Lord, we've come to bless you. We've come to lift our praise unto you this morning.
Wasn't holding you up. ocean so I wouldn't drown.
You've never been closer than you are right now. You are
shattered. You are known. Shattered. You are known. And I will be content in every circumstance.
song because it's so familiar and all of us know this song. Sometimes we sing it so mindlessly and we forget what we're actually singing, the truth that we are speaking over ourselves. Jireh in Hebrew means the Lord will provide. And so what you're singing is that, man, he is our provider. So whatever circumstance that you are facing this morning, whatever you have come in with this morning, none of it is too much for him. He is our provider. Church, I encourage you to bring back into remembrance the goodness of God over your life. Bring back to remembrance what he has done to bring you to this point here today, that you get to stand here today with breath in your lungs. And if that is not evidence of the goodness of God, then I don't know what is. So whatever you are facing this morning, remind yourself who is in control, who is the one who's seated on the throne, who has his hand over every circumstance, who is guiding your way, even when you cannot see the next step. Our Jehovah Jireh is continuously making a way, continuously providing, and that he has led you to where you are today. Even if you are lacking in that faith this morning, I encourage you to sing the lyrics and allow that to be your truth this morning. Sing it until it becomes your truth this morning. So we're going to sing that again and remind yourself that Jireh means the Lord will provide, Lord will provide over your circumstance.
working in us. He's moving in love. He's more than you ask, think, or imagine. According to His power, working in us. It's more than enough. It's more than you ask, think, or imagine. According to His power, working in us. You're more than enough. 'Cause you are Jireh.
You are enough. Jireh, you are enough. And I will be content in every circumstance.
Providing and that you never fail. Jesus, we thank you. Jesus, we thank you. You're faithful. Jesus, we thank you. Because you're faithful. You never fail me, no, you don't. Oh, the perfect Son of God, in all His innocence, He's walking in the dirt with you and me. He knows what living is, He's acquainted with our grief. The man of sorrow, son of suffering. Oh, the perfect Son of God, in all His innocence. And He's walking in the dirt with you and me. Oh, He knows what living is, He's acquainted with our grief. He's the man of sorrow, son of suffering. Oh, blood and tears, how can it be that there's a God who weeps and there's a God who bleeds? Oh, praise the one who would reach for me. Oh, you chased us down in merciful pursuit. To the Savior of grace and the broken you embraced. And in the end the proof is in your works. Oh, I'm not afraid.
There's a God who bleeds. Oh, praise
the one who would reach for me. Hallelujah to the Son of suffering. Oh, blood and tears, how can it be? There's a God who weeps, and there's a God who bleeds. Oh, praise the one who would reach for me. Hallelujah to the Son of suffering. Jesus, we pray this morning that your cross, what you've done, that it will be fresh revelation that will wash over us every day. That you are acquainted with our grief. That you're the Son of suffering. That though we may face trials, that we can overcome them because of your blood, Jesus. And we thank you for your sacrifice, Father God. And would you just remind us every day that we're free because of your blood. And so we thank you, Lord. And we bless your name this morning. It's in your Son, Jesus, we pray. Amen.
And amen. Praise the Lord, church. Come on, if you believe that he cares for the birds, if he dresses the lilies of the valleys, how much more does he care for us? Come on, if you believe that, can we just give God a shout of praise today? Amen, amen. Hey, listen, good morning, church. Welcome to the Altar Church. Whether you've been with us here before, if it's your first time, I just want to say welcome. We're so glad you're here. Isn't it just amazing that we get to come together and just praise God and worship him as a community, as a church together, amen? Especially if you're watching online, we just want to welcome you. And before we get into the message today, I got some announcements. As you guys know, every Monday we have our prayer call, Monday 7 p.m. on Zoom. So if you guys are able to join, man, just it's amazing, right? We're just able to come together as a community, wherever we're calling in from, and just able to pray together over different needs that we see in our community for our church. And we've seen so many of these prayer requests answered already, right? So if you're able to join Monday 7 p.m., please make sure to join with us. And then Sunday the 31st, next Sunday is Easter Sunday. And then we have our fasting and prayer meeting on April 6th Saturday, and then April 7th will be Communion Sunday. So make sure to add these events to your calendars and join us. Let's just pray one more time before we go in. Father, we thank you for this day, Lord. We thank you for all that you're doing in this place, Jesus. Holy Spirit, we feel you in this place, Father God. We pray that you just have your way, God. We just have your way in this place. Pray that, Lord, you're opening up our minds and our hearts to receive from you, to hear from you, Jesus. That when we leave this place, we don't walk out the same way that we walked in, but we have an encounter from you, Jesus. It's not about how many songs we sing. It's not about how many people we could bring into the door, Father God, but we just want to seek you, Father. So help us align our hearts with you, Father, just to seek your face, just to see you in this place, Father. And we just give all glory and honor to your name. It's in Jesus' most precious name that we pray. Amen. Amen. Come on, church. You know, for the last few weeks, matter of fact, for the last few months as a church, we have been learning about the new vision statement that we're implementing here at the church, right? And by this point, you guys should have it memorized. So say it with me. The first one is love. Second one, build. Third one, awesome. So you guys are getting the hang of it. First one, loving. We say we advance his kingdom by loving on all people as Jesus did, right? Second is building. We build relationships with Christ, our family, each other, and our community. And then third is growing. We say we continuously grow and develop in Christ, both individually and corporately. And the topic that was given to me to speak on this week was building a godly life. Say it with me, building a godly life. You know, that sounded cool, you know, building a godly life. And I was like, you know, as I was thinking about it, as I was learning about it, I realized what this really means is that we allow Jesus to be the center of our life, right? We're dependent on him, right? Everything that we do now is revolved around who is this man, Jesus Christ, right? And as I was thinking, all the sermons we've been hearing in the past few weeks, to be honest, the past few months on this series involve this idea of building a godly life, right? Just a quick recap. We started with, what is the first vision statement? Love, right? We heard about how God loves you. Then we heard, do you love yourself? We heard about loving your neighbor. Then we heard about loving your children and family, right? We can't know how to love without knowing God who is love. So again, God is at the center of all this. Then we started on building. We heard about building a relationship with God. Sounds like God's pretty involved in that one, right? And then we heard building the church, the heart of a builder, and then building a godly home, right? Again, in all these things, Jesus or God has to be at the center. So I felt like all of it related to this topic of building a godly life. So yes, we're going to talk about that, but specifically today, I want to talk about finding strength in God. If you're here today, yell strength with God. I just want to make sure you're awake. Listen, I'm on two cups of coffee already, so y'all need to match my energy. If you got your Bibles with you, turn with me to Isaiah 40. We're going to read from verses 27 to 31. Isaiah 40, verse 27 to 31. It reads like this. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God? Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. Verse 29, he gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. So see, as we're reading this, right, it's the prophet Isaiah speaking, and he's telling the Israelites this promise of a renewed strength from the Lord, the kind of strength that's compared to an eagle, or the kind of strength where they say you could keep running and you won't get tired, right? Listen, I don't know about you, but I hate doing cardio. I can lift weights for hours, but doing cardio just sucks. I get tired, right? And the gym I go to, I got a problem with them because the machines are broken. Right? I feel like I'm running for an hour or climbing the steps for an hour, and the machine says it's only been 4 minutes. So when I read this, I'm like, Lord, I need that strength, whatever that is, right? You can keep going without getting tired. So the Lord gives you strength like an eagle. So why does this matter for the Israelites? To break into the context, at this point in history, the Israelites are in exile, right? They're living in a place called Babylon, and they were forced to leave their homeland. They were forced to work here long hours, difficult jobs, and they're starting to feel tired out. Right, the Israelites are starting to complain. They honestly feel like the Lord has forgotten them. They feel like God has abandoned them. Right? They're probably thinking, man, we're supposed to be the promised people of God, his chosen people. So God, don't you see us struggling? God, don't you see that we're tired? God, where have you been? These are the questions that the Israelites are asking as they're in exile, right? Lord, we thought we were your promised people. Have you forgotten about us? These are the questions that the Israelites are asking, right? They said, Lord, you promised such great things for us. But in this season right now, we just don't see it yet. God, where are you? We read that in verse 27. Let's read that again. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord. My right is disregarded by God. See, in that verse, you see how upset they are, the despair that they're feeling. See, they came to this conclusion that either God couldn't help or that he didn't want to. They were exhausted. They were tired. Even in the verses, in these few, four or five verses, we see the number of times Isaiah uses the words faint and weary, right? It emphasizes how tired the people are feeling. And they start questioning, God, do you even care? Listen, it wasn't just a physical tiredness, right? It was a spiritual tiredness too. If we're God's chosen people, Lord, where have you been? Why aren't you doing anything? Do you not even care? And church, can we be real today? Right, a lot of times it's easier for us to put on a smile and act like everything's fine, right? Even in our spiritual lives, there's going to be seasons where we're on the mountaintops and we feel like we're best friends with God and we feel like, you know, everything's at its best. But there's also seasons where we go through the valleys, right? Where we start questioning, we start doubting, Lord, why are these things happening? Lord, you had a promise for my life. Why am I not seeing it come true yet? Right? Some of you may be even asking these things today, and that's kind of what the Israelites were going through in this season. Lord, you promised. You promised these things. Why haven't we seen it yet? And we start to wonder, does God really see me? Does God really care? Lord, if you do, why aren't you doing anything, right? And like I said, we've asked these questions. This is what Israelites are feeling. They were stripped away from their homeland, something that was promised to them. They were taken away in exile to a foreign land, forced to work as slaves, forced to work these long hours, difficult jobs. And they're asking God, don't you care? Why aren't you doing anything, right? And sometimes we're feeling tired because just like the Israelites, we're giving up hope that God could do something. Right, when you feel like the Lord has spoken something to you, the first few days when we start praying, it's easy, right? It's like, Lord, I trust in you. You got all power and authority in your hands. I know that you can do it. And then a year goes by. Lord, I'm still praying. Lord, I'm not discouraged. I still believe in you. You know, I seen you do it for others. God, I know you can still do it. Then 2 years go by, 3 years go by, 5 years go by, and you're still praying for the same thing. God is me again. Lord, I'm still waiting, you know, but would you mind speeding things up a bit? Right? See, Isaiah starts addresses these questions then in verse 28. He says, have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. Listen, I don't know if you realize, in this one verse, Isaiah is hitting on some of the four core beliefs that the people had about God. And I want to break that down. Ready? The first is that Isaiah acknowledges that the Lord is everlasting. See, what that means is that he's not constrained by our definition of time, right? He was in our past. He's in our present. He is in our future. He's the everlasting God. He was powerful then. He's powerful today. He's powerful in our future. And he's over all time. He's sovereign over all time. The Lord is not constrained by our definition of time. He's everlasting. That means his actions extend far beyond our current situation. He is working daily. Second, he says that God is the creator, obviously referring to the creation story we see in the beginning of Genesis, right? And the Lord that was powerful to create the heavens and the earth, the lilies of the valley, the birds who created us, he is not done working yet. His power is not limited. If he was able to create then, he is still this everlasting God. He can still create new things in our lives today. He is not done yet. He is not limited in his power. Third, Isaiah says that the Lord's strength has no limits. He says he does not grow faint. He does not grow weary. You might grow faint. You could bring the strongest person in the world into this room, but they have limits of how much they can do. But our God is not like human strength. His strength is divine. And listen, when we wait on him, he's able to pour that into us as well. His definition of strength is not what ours is like. He is the everlasting God. He is all powerful. He is almighty. And lastly, Isaiah says this, that the Lord's knowledge is more than anything that we could comprehend. Lord, your ways are higher than mine. Lord, you know much better than I do. So can we trust in the Lord? So when the people ask, does God even see us? Does he even care? Isaiah is reminding them, you were speaking to the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the one who had a plan and purpose for your life before you were even born. Can you continue to have trust in him? He sees all things. His knowledge is so much greater than anything we could comprehend. He sees each and every deep emotion you're feeling, every thought that you're having. And that should bring you comfort. To know that the God of heaven and earth cares about what you're feeling in this moment. He cannot forget you. He does care, but can you trust in him? To know that God is fully capable of giving us the guidance, the wisdom, and the comfort we need in our times of need. Continue on, let's read verses 29 and 30. Verse 29 and 30. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. Right? So what Isaiah's saying here is, even those in their prime age, they're limited to how much they can do, how much work they can do, how strong they are. But with the strength that we receive from God is different. The strength that we receive from God. Listen, sometimes the battles and situations that we face is so much greater than that we can handle on our own strength. And in those moments, in those times, we need to lean on something, someone that's greater, a source of strength that's greater than anything that we could do. And as Isaiah is reminding them, the answer that we're looking for is God. Then verse 31, but those who wait for the Lord shall what? Renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Listen, we're going to be sitting on this verse for a while. Ready? They who wait for the Lord, he shall renew their strength. It doesn't say those who work for the Lord, right? It doesn't say those who are the strongest for the Lord. It says those who wait for the Lord. It's a relationship. It shows a dependency, right? It's with us and our Heavenly Father, this God. There's a dependency that we wait on the Lord. Listen, sometimes we get this wrong idea of what waiting means. When we talk about wait, it's not just sitting around, hands in your pocket. No, no, no. Listen, the Hebrew word for wait there is kawa. And what it means is it's not a passive word. It's an active word, right? Y'all don't get it. It's an active word. That means I'm not just sitting around on the couch and waiting for something to happen. No, it means I'm waiting on the Lord in anticipation. I'm waiting for when He speaks. I'm waiting for His direction. I'm waiting for Him to tell me when it's time to move. Because when God says it's time to move, we better be ready to go. When He says it's time for war, we better be ready to fight. It's an active waiting, right? And listen. A waiting season is not a wasted season. A waiting season is not a wasted season. I want you to think about it this way. Ready? Imagine a soldier who's getting ready for war. He has his armor on. He has his weapon in his hand, right? And he's ready to barge into whatever the warfare is. He's not sitting with hands in his pocket, right? No, no, no. He's ready to go. But who is he listening for? He's waiting for the voice of his commander. As soon as he says it's go time, the soldier's ready. Or think about this. I know a lot of y'all football fans, right? When the player is on the field and they're getting ready to run, right? They're not sitting with their hands in their pockets. No, no, no. Listen, they're waiting on the quarterback or someone to yell hike because they know when they give the command, it's go time. In the same way, we're not just waiting, sitting around for things to happen. We're waiting on the Lord. We're waiting in anticipation because when He says it's time to go, I'm going to be ready. I'm going to be prepared. That's not when I put on my armor. That's not when I put on my football gear. When He says it's time to go, I'm ready because I'm listening to Him. I'm waiting on the Lord. See, sometimes we think that the things just come to us, but no. If you're sitting in His presence, if you're waiting on Him, that's when things change. We're attuned to the voice of our Heavenly Father. And when He says it's time, we're ready. Right? This is what Isaiah is telling the Israelites, to wait on the Lord, to have hope, to have confidence, even in the toughest situations. Listen, the season you're in right now might suck, right? You might be questioning, why are these things happening? But like Isaiah's reminding us, the Lord cannot forget you. He has a promise over you. So you better wait and trust in God who created you, who had a plan and purpose for you. Because when it's go time, when He says it's time to move, your season of victory is coming, but you do not want to miss the opportunity, right? That season is coming. Right now, we might be going through the valleys, but it's a journey to get to the mountaintop. And when the Lord said, and we're waiting on the Lord, we rely on Him for that strength. We rely on Him for that guidance. We rely on Him for that wisdom. It's not on my own strength, but I rely on someone who's greater, who is stronger, who has more knowledge, and I will wait on Him. See, it's not about how much I could do on my own, right? It's not about how much strength I have, how much skills I have, but it's saying, God, I need you. It's the kind of strength that we can only get from our Heavenly Father. Holy Spirit, have your way. Listen, church. Again, to build a godly life, it's not about what we could do, but we're everything is dependent on our Heavenly Father. We're seeking Him for that guidance, that wisdom. We're seeking Him for the direction. Right? We may not understand it in the moment. We trust in the one who's writing our story. So we wait on the Lord. Even in our hardest situations, we wait on the Lord. Even when we don't understand, we wait on the Lord. Even when it feels like the enemies are surrounding us, we wait on the Lord because our trust should be in Him. When we get tired, we wait on the Lord. When we feel weak, we wait on the Lord. See, a verse that we often refer to is Matthew 11:28. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Even in the New Testament, Jesus is saying, when we wait on Him, we can find rest in Him, right? The Son of God who bore our sins on the cross. The Son of God who was raised from the dead. This is the man that I choose to center my life around. This is the God that I trust. Because I remember in my past, when I didn't know how things were going to work out, He always came through. In my family, when we didn't know how things were going to work out, I know we could lean on the Lord. In the Bible, from the Old Testament to the New Testament, the common theme I see is how the Lord provides for His people. But in those times, can we continue to wait on Him? For when I am weak, what does the Bible say? He is strong, right? When I can't do it on my own strength, I trust in the one who has all. This is the God I choose to listen to. This is the God I choose to depend on. This is the God I seek my strength from. Again, a waiting season is not a wasted season. Sometimes we gotta understand this too, ready? Sometimes waiting means surrendering. Now that's the part not everybody likes to hear, right? Because we always have this idea that we already have a life plan, that this perfect idea of what our future is gonna look like. I'm gonna get this degree by this time. I'm gonna get married by this time. I'm gonna accomplish these things by this time, right? But sometimes waiting on the Lord means surrendering. Some of that means we have to recognize the things that we want may not always be what's in God's will for us too. But can we surrender those things to him, right? Sometimes we think we know what we want to accomplish in our life or the different things we need to get done, but his timeline might be different. Can we surrender to him, right? It might be surrendering control and letting God determine the outcome of our battles. Sometimes we think we got to keep fighting for certain things, so it comes out one way, but maybe the Lord is saying, you're not even supposed to be in that situation. Can we surrender to the Lord? And then continuing that verse, or surrendering and waiting on him is also an act of worship because we recognize maybe I don't know all this, but you know what? I trust in you, God. I rely on you. And then continuing that verse, we read, they shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Listen, y'all know I'm from Philadelphia. So as soon as I said something about the Eagles, you know I had to say something, right? I'll just leave it at this. When I read the Bible, you see God talks about the Eagles a lot and in a positive way, right? I'm coming to you. Don't worry. I know we got some New York people in the house, right? New York, let me hear you. All right, that was weak. If Philly was in the house, we'd be going crazy. That's all I'm saying. But the Bible talks about giants too, even though they fall all the time. I'm just saying to my Texas friends, I'm sorry, but I don't see nothing about no cowboys in the Bible. And I know, I brought this up before, somebody said shepherds are basically the same thing as cowboys, and that's a stretch. Doesn't count. But anyway, when we talk about the eagle, right, I started doing research into it, and you already know eagles are crazy birds, right? Not the football team, I'm talking about the animal, but they're strong. If you ever seen one in person before, you know they have big, strong wings, right? But see, they work very different from any other bird. If you ever seen them up close, you know their wings are giant. But where most other birds would flap their wings to fly, an eagle doesn't do the same. If you've seen an eagle fly in the sky before, right? Usually its wings are just out straight and it's gliding. It's soaring. Again, the wings of an eagle are so heavy, right? The amount of energy it needs to use to flap its wings if it flapped its wings like any other bird, the eagle wouldn't survive long. Because of how heavy it is, versus when it's dependent on the wind current and it's just gliding, it only uses about 20% of its energy. So you see, the eagle is very dependent on the wind currents to know where it's going to go, to rely on that for its source of strength of to being able to glide, to be able to soar, right? Again, its wings may look like most other birds, but it's designed for a different purpose. It's designed to work a different way, right? The eagle may be able to flap its wings, but if it's not using the way it's supposed to, it's going to hurt him more than it is helping him. So the eagle is dependent on the wind current, right? When they soar with the wind, they actually only use about 20% of the energy that they would versus if they were flapping their wings. Now you see, most animals, most birds, even most people, when they see a storm coming, they'd go in the opposite direction. But an eagle recognizes in the storm there's such a strong wind current, the eagle starts flying towards the storm. Now, why would it do that, right? The eagle knows even though there's a temporary discomfort, on the other end of it, the wind that he gains from the storm is going to be able to take it further, so much farther than it could on its own strength, right? It knows that even though there's a temporary discomfort, that even though it's a temporary season, what's on the other end is going to be greater, right? The destination that it's going to go to, it's dependent on the wind current. So versus where most animals would run away from the storm, the eagle actually embraces it. In the same way, when we choose to wait on God and rely on him as our source of strength, the way the eagle waits for the wind, right? We conserve our energy because instead of fighting on our own strength, trying to figure out our own knowledge, we rely on the Lord. We allow him to guide our steps. He already ordained each and every one of our steps. He has a plan and purpose. When we're reliant on him, we trust in him, right? We don't have to fear about what the enemy says, what the people around us says. We're relying on the Lord. We allow him to determine our flight path. We allow him to determine the direction of our lives, and we're focused on him. See, a lot of times we face struggles and we feel weak when we try to battle the storms on our own strength because we think we know what's best, right? We might be pushing, we might be fighting, trying everything that we have, but he says, if you would just wait on me, if you would just trust in me, if instead of flapping our wings like other birds, right, we could trust in the Lord and allow him to guide our lives. Wait on the Lord. In the same way the eagle relies on the wind, we should rely on the Holy Spirit to give us the direction. And when we're walking in our purpose, walking the way God has designed for us, listen, we might look like the people around us. The eagle might look like the birds around him, right? But he was designed to do something different. We see, we might try to replicate the people around us. Our parents might try to compare us to other people. Say, look, so-and-so did this, right? Or say, for example, if I was a preacher and I want to be like other pastors, I'm not falling into what God has planned for me. He has a purpose for each and every one of us. So if you're waiting on him instead of trying to be like the other birds. What if we were like the eagle to try to replicate a pigeon? The pigeon is flapping its wings, but if the eagle did the same, it's gonna die, right? So we wait on the Lord, seek him. When we trust in him, he has a plan and purpose. And when we start walking in that, things change. Because we're not focused on what the people around us are saying no more. We're not focused on what other people in our circle are doing, but we're focused on the Lord. Again, there's a dependency on him. Living a godly life, we're centering Jesus at the center of everything. Verse 31 says this, continuing, but those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. So coming back to Isaiah speaking this to the Israelites, right? He's reminding them, hey, listen, we need to have complete dependence on our God. We need to trust in him. And he's saying, listen, I know it's hard right now. I know it feels like we're struggling right now, right? I know we're questioning, why are these things happening? God, can't you do anything? We're questioning, we're doubting, we're wondering. But if we were to wait on him, he's the one that provides us the strength to sustain us through every situation that we face. If you would just wait on him. I know it might be tough right now. I know we're questioning what's happening on the other end of this. But if you would just wait on him, it is God Almighty that sustains us. It is God Almighty that gives us strength. Would you just wait on your Heavenly Father? Would you continue to put your trust in him? Because those who wait on the Lord, he what? Renews their strength. It is him that sustains us. Listen, this is not something we just hear in the Old Testament. We see this over and over again in the New Testament too, right? How God is the one that strengthens us. I'm not going to read through all these verses, but just to run through, Ephesians 3:20, Paul tells us how God's power is at work in us. In James 1 verse 12, you can read this later, it says that great is the reward for those who trust in God through trials. Then in Hebrews 12:2, he says to run the race with perseverance. And then coming back to Isaiah, what we're just reading, it's the Lord that renews our strength. Say renews. Listen, what I learned from that is, ready? The goal is not for us to be full. Pastor Ron, what does that mean? That doesn't make sense. I'm glad you asked. Ready? When he gives us strength, it's for us to use in service for him. Right? The goal is not for us to be full. He pours into us, then we pour out to others. Now, y'all didn't catch that. He pours into us, then we pour out into others, right? The goal is not for us to be full. It's not a one and done type of thing. Sometimes people think you just say a magical prayer and now you have your ticket to heaven. No, that's not how it is, right? When we come to the presence of God, when we allow him into our lives, he gives us strength. Then we are commanded to do works for the kingdom of God. Yes, you're going to feel tired. You might feel like you're pouring out, but that's when you come back to his presence and strength is renewed, right? Think about this. How many of you in here drive? Most of you, right? So in order for your car to work, you need to fill it with gas, right? For all you electric car people, just sit tight for a minute, okay? But listen. In order for your car to function the way it needs to, you need to fill it with gas. A car that stays full is a car that doesn't move. A car that stays full is a car that doesn't move. It has the potential. It has the capability to travel, to drive, to take you from point A to B, right? But if it stays full, that means it's not moving. If it's not moving, it's not functioning the way it's designed to be. What's the purpose of a car if it just sits still? It's supposed to move. But listen, does the gasoline get used up? Yes, right? But when it's empty, you don't just get rid of it and buy a new car. If you do, let's talk after church. But listen, when it uses up the gas, right, it's supposed to go back to the source of power. Come on, y'all ain't getting it. It goes back to the source of power, gets refilled, then you use it again, right? It has strengths, it has capabilities. If it's not, it's not functioning the way it's designed to be. You can't drive a car that's empty. But if it stays full, it's not being used the way it's supposed to. Another analogy, y'all know I love metaphors, ready? Most of y'all have your phones, right? It might be in your bag, it might be in your pocket, some of y'all playing on it right now. But listen, listen, listen. The phone has so much capability of different things it could do, right? It has so much that you could do with it. But if you don't charge it for a week, what's gonna happen? It's gonna die, right? Imagine if every time it died, you just threw it and bought a new phone. Well, that would be wasteful, right? Because it's designed to be recharged, right? It has the capabilities, but if you don't charge it, it's going to die. If you leave it for a week, it's going to die, right? It has to be connected to a source of power. Listen, you might be able to plug in the cable on one end, but it may look like it's in a position to receive power, but until it's plugged in, until it's connected to a source of power, it's useless, right? Listen, I'm about to step on some toes, ready? Can I preach today? Come on, ready, ready? Listen, so why is it that some people come to church on a Sunday, but then never read their Bible or go back into prayer throughout the rest of the week, and then have the audacity to say, God, do you hear me? God, do you see me? When you're not going back to the source of power. You feel tired, you feel weak, but are we really going back into his presence enough? You could have the phone, you could connect one end of the cable, but until it's connected to the source. What's the purpose? Until it's connected to the source. Sometimes we say we feel tired, we feel weak. We ask, Lord, do you even see me? Do you hear me? But do you really go into his presence enough? Y'all, you don't understand. Listen, before in the past, the people had to go through a priest in order to be able to speak to God, right? But that's not the case. When Jesus died on that cross, there was a new covenant. There was something new that happened. Now we have access to the presence of God. That's a gift that we don't use as much as we should be, right? That's like saying you have the phone, you're connected to the cable, but you're choosing not to plug it in. You have to be connected to the source. To the one that gives us power. They who wait on the Lord shall what? Renew their strength. It's not a one and done type of thing. It's a relationship. It's a cycle. So he pours into us. We pour out onto others. And then when we get tired, we go back to the source of strength. It's not like ordinary strength. It's not like anything else we can find in this world. But the strength that we seek from God, it's a divine strength. So it only gets it from one source. See, people try to find happiness and joy and peace in all these other things that the world says is true. But no, listen, none of those things compared to what we receive from our Heavenly Father. Some people don't recognize that we have access to the presence of God. You don't have to wait for a Sunday service. You don't have to wait for a conference. Wherever you are, in your homes, while you're driving, at your school place, you have access to the presence of God. But yet we still feel tired. Are you connected to the source? Again, just because you come to church doesn't mean you're connected to the source, right? You have to actively seek his presence. It doesn't have to be just at church. Wherever you are we seeking his presence? Because when we do, when we continuously seek him, again, it's a relationship, right? When we continuously seek him, he gives us the strength that we need. He pours into us. And then we're commanded to do work for the kingdom of God. It's not to store it up, right? It's not, okay, I got saved. Okay, I got baptized, and then it's done. No, no, no. When we do work, we're going to get tired. But do you come back to his presence? Do you come back to that source of power? Do you come back to seek your Heavenly Father? Because that's where we find strength. When we align our lives around him, we make Jesus the center of our life. And that's what godly living looks like, or building a godly life looks like. Just as God provided for the nation of Israel, church, let me tell you, he can still provide for us today. The God who had all power and authority then is still the same God that's working today, who's working in our future. You might feel stuck right now. You might not know how tomorrow's going to work out. But let me tell you, if you would trust in him, if you would just wait on him, if you would just trust in your Heavenly Father, the one who knows all things, who has a plan and purpose for our lives, right? We're not going on our own strength, our own knowledge, because we are limited by trusting a God who has all power in his hand. Jesus. See, now some of you ask this question. If God's so powerful, if God's so mighty, why doesn't he just make everything perfect to begin with? God, you see the struggles that I'm going through. Why don't you just make it work out from the start, right? But listen, if God gave us everything, we wouldn't need faith. It's like what we spoke a few weeks ago, right? How do we know if our faith stands unless it gets tested? See, God wouldn't put us through a trial unless he knows that we have the capability to withstand those things. But when we feel tired, when we feel weak, do we go back into his presence to find strength? If we're truly living a godly life, God is at the center of it all, right? And we trust in him. We find our strength in him. Even when life seems to be crazy, even when in the season where we feel like we don't know why it's happening, what's going on, can we just continue to wait on him, to continue to have faith in him, to trust in him? Listen, some of us complain more about our situations than we actually spend time praying about it, right? Can I be real today? Come on, you talk to your friends, you talk to the people around you, say, man, I just feel stuck, I'm going through all these things. But do you spend as much time going into the presence of God and praying about those situations? Just like the phone that's only charged once a week, right? We can say how we're tired, we can say that we're drained, but if we're not intentionally seeking the power source, right? The phone's gonna be dead. We're gonna feel weak, we're gonna feel drained. We have this access to the presence of God. We have this access to a God who gives us this divine strength. Ready, I'm gonna say something that not everyone's gonna like now, ready? Some of you guys, or some people listening, are more fans of Jesus than you are followers of Jesus. Pass around, what does that mean? Glad you asked. Ready? Fans are people who like something, but they're not very committed to it, right? Like, I can say I'm a fan of the Philadelphia Eagles football team. That's my city, right? But if they lose a game or if they trade a player, it's not affecting me personally because I have no, I'm not sacrificing anything for them. I don't have a commitment to them, right? I could be a fan, but when things get hard, it's easy to walk away, right? Fans are people who could cheer for Jesus in their good seasons, but when things get tough, it's easy for them to walk away because they have no commitment, right? It's almost like it's just for show. For fans, they don't think that following Jesus requires a sacrifice or a change. For fans, they think once they said a prayer, they got their ticket to heaven. For fans, they want to know Jesus, but they don't really want to follow him. For fans, they want the rewards without the relationship. See, now, a follower is different. A follower chooses to want to know Christ, to be loved by him, to love on him, to learn from him. A follower is different. A follower is ready to make sacrifices or for whatever is needed to follow God, to walk in the ways that he is designed to be, right? A follower is obedient. When Jesus says to move, he's ready to move. When Jesus says to do something, he's ready to do it, right? A follower is not afraid to make sacrifices for God. A follower is ready to surrender it all for him if it comes to it. A fan versus a follower is very different. See, again, a fan doesn't have much of a commitment. It's easy for them to walk away. But a follower says, Jesus, I will follow you to the ends of the earth. Whatever you need from me, God, I trust in you. Whatever you tell me to do, I trust in your ways are higher than mine. You know so much better than I do. I put my full trust in you. So church, are you a fan of Jesus or are you a follower today? I want to talk about the ego one last time. Worship team, you guys can start coming up. Going back to the eagle, right? We already established it's a strong bird, right? The eagle, it functions different from the way most other birds do. But there's something else that makes the eagle special. See, all of us have eyelids, right? When we close our eyes, the eyelid closes. The eagle has the same thing. But the eagle also has what's called a nictitating membrane. That sounds weird, right? But it's essentially a second pair of eyelids where it's thin enough that it can see through, but it also protects the eagle's eyes from the sunlight. The only known predator or the enemy for an eagle is a bird called the condor, right? And the condor is a big bird too. The wings are almost twice the size of an eagle. So the condor knows the only time, the condor can't fly as well as an eagle. So the condor knows the only time it can attack an eagle is when the eagle is on the ground, when it is at its most vulnerable place. The condor knows if the eagle starts flying, it can't hurt him. But when the eagle's on the ground, that's when it's most vulnerable, right? So what does the eagle do when it sees the condor coming? The eagle starts flying towards the sun. Listen, it has those special eyelids. It uses that, right? Because it knows it can stare at the sun and the sunlight won't affect its vision. But this other bird cannot fly as much. It cannot fly as well. So when the eagle starts flying toward the sun, the condor can try to chase it. But in the presence of the light, the condor cannot follow. The eagle finds safety in the presence of the sun, S-U-N, because it loses the enemy in the light. Listen, church, in the same way, right? The eagle is vulnerable when it's on the ground. So the enemy tries to push us around, when we're vulnerable, when we're going through those valley seasons, that's when the voice of the enemy tries to get into our head and says, you're not enough, you can't do it, whatever it may be, right? But that's when we have to run into the presence of the Son, S-O-N, Son of God, because we know when we're walking in the purpose, when we're walking in His will, His presence is around us. And when we're in His presence, the light of our God overcomes any darkness of the enemy. Y'all don't hear it. When we're in His presence, we no longer need to fear, because the one that we're standing with, y'all don't get it, the one that we trust, the one that we put our faith in, He's fighting on our behalf. He is taking care of us. The same way, listen, the eagle has those special skills, right? The eyelids that it could use, but if it didn't use it, it's going to waste. It's not functioning the way it's designed to be. In the same way, we have been given everything we need to fight these spiritual battles, to fight the spiritual warfare. We have this access to the presence of God. So when the eagle's getting chased by the other bird, he goes into the source of sun, because he knows the enemy in the light. Come on, when you're going through those battles today, where do you find your source of strength? Whew. Where do you find your source of strength? We need to be dependent on God. Find our strength in Him. Have our faith in Him. Man, we may not know how it's always going to work out, but listen, the same way the eagle runs towards the sun, right? It lifts its eyes up. My Bible tells me when I go through trials to fix my eyes on Jesus, because that is the one I focus on. In His presence, the enemy cannot follow. The enemy cannot hurt me. Matter of fact, in Psalms 21, it says this: I lift my eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from? Come on, you know this, church. Say it with me. My help comes from the Lord, who made the heavens and the earth. He will not let your foot be moved. He keeps you, will not slumber. He who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. Come on, who am I speaking to today? The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. The Lord will keep your going out, your coming in, from this time on, for forevermore. So when you're going through those struggles, where do you find your strength? When you're questioning, God, do you see me? Where do you go to? Listen. It's easy for us to put our trust in our friends or in our job or whatever it may be. But when you're really struggling, the strength that we get from God is different. Will you wait on Him? Will you wait on Him today, church? Come on. Oh, Jesus, have your way. Listen, just like the Israelites, how easy is it for us to forget sometimes what a mighty God we serve? How great He is, how strong He is. He is the creator, He is the everlasting. He has all power and authority in His hands. So if He was able to make a way for the Israelites, can He still work in our lives today? Will you just wait on Him? Will you put your trust in Him? Because I know the God who is still working in my life today, He is not done writing my story. So when I question, come on, church, when I doubt, just like the eagle goes towards the sun, I'm going into the presence of God, because that is where my safety is. That is where I know the one who has all things in His hands. In His presence, the enemy cannot attack. The enemy cannot hurt me, because the presence of God is there. Listen, it's a gift that we have, but we don't use it as often as we should. It's not just coming to church on a Sunday. It's not just going to conference once a year, right? It's a continual thing to go into His presence, to seek the power source, to be renewed in our strength. It's not a one and done thing. It says renewed. It's a cycle. But will you wait on Him? Again, sometimes the eagle has to go through the storms before it gets to a better place on the other end. But it knows this temporary discomfort is only going to help it to get somewhere else. Will you just wait on the Lord? I may not know what tomorrow looks like. I may not know how my finances will work. I may not have security in my job, but I trust in the one who brought me here. See, again, it's easy for a fan to walk away because they have no commitment. But when you are a follower of Jesus, you are trusting in Him. You're invested. So when He says to surrender something, I have no fear of surrendering. When He says to sacrifice something, I have no fear, because I trust in Him. I may not always know how it's going to work out, but my strength is found in my Heavenly Father. So we continue to actively wait on Him. When He says it's go time, you better be ready to go. Right? When He says it's time to fight battles, you better be ready for war. Come on, in His presence is where our strength is renewed. Some of y'all feel tired. Some of y'all feel weak. Some of y'all going through the same season the Israelites were right now. You're asking, God, do you even see what's going on? God, where are you? God, do you not care? Right? But if you would just wait on him and trust that he works all things together for good. You don't have to go through these things on your own strength. That's a lot of times when we feel drained, when we feel weary, because we try to fight these battles, fight these situations the way we think it should happen instead of seeking his presence, trusting in the guidance of the Almighty God. Some of you are in that situation right now where you feel tired, where you feel drained, but let me tell you, the answer is Jesus. That's where we are, our strength is renewed. Will you just wait on him? Listen, so you might be like the Israelites. It's not just a physical tiredness, it's a spiritual tiredness. You're hearing about this man Jesus and you're saying, I want that strength. No. I need that strength. A divine strength. That's not like anything I could get from my support system, from my finances, from anything else. I need something supernatural to work in my circumstances. And let me tell you, don't miss this opportunity right now. If you never allowed Jesus into your life before and you're saying, man, I need that strength. I need something to change in my situations. It's as easy as ABC. Right? A is admitting that we all are sinners. The Bible says we all sin and fall short of the glory of God. B is believing that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And then C is confessing our sins. Listen, church, I'm gonna say this one last thing. Ready? It cost us nothing to be forgiven from our sins, but it costs us everything to follow him. I'm gonna say that again. It costs us nothing to be forgiven from our sins. Right? It's a free gift. The Bible says we just have to pray and seek him, but it costs us everything to follow him after. But those who wait on the Lord, listen, those who wait on the Lord, they shall be renewed in their strength. They shall mount up on wings like eagles. They shall run and not grow faint or weary. Can you wait on him today? Come on, church, can you just stand up in this place? Come on, listen, if you're feeling tired, if you're feeling broken, whatever it is that you're needing from him, can you just wait on him? Can you trust in your heavenly Father that he can make a way in all of your situations, whatever it may be? Jesus, have your way in this place. Jesus, have your way in this place. Again, if you never allowed Jesus into your life before, don't miss this opportunity right now. It's him that changes the situations of our lives. Would you just wait on him? The same way the eagle goes towards the sun because it knows it loses the enemy in the presence of the light. Come on, when we start walking in our situation knowing that God is by our side, we no longer fear, we no longer doubt, because we know in his presence, things have to change. In his presence, chains have to break. In his presence, healing takes place. In his presence, peace comes down in ways that we've never felt before. In his presence, come on, would you just wait on him? So Father God, we just surrender all to your hands, Father. In every situation, in every battle that we go through, God, we just give it all to your hands, Jesus. Come on, can we just lift a shout of praise in this place? Lord, we just surrender it all to you, Father God. In everything that we do, Lord, we want to make you the center of our life, Father God. We put our trust in you. We just want to put our full trust in you, Jesus. We put our faith in you, God.
wait on the Lord. It took Nehemiah 120 days to wait on the Lord. It took Nehemiah to wait on the Lord for 120 days. But it just took 52 days to rebuild the temple walls. Hallelujah. Do I have a witness in the house? If you wait on the Lord, hallelujah, you would never know the way that God is going to rebuild things in your life. And this morning, I want to encourage you, church, no matter the way and the time that you wait for the Lord, it's going to be instant. Sometimes it would take 52 days, but sometimes it would just take 10 days. But are you ready? Are you ready to wait upon the Lord? Are you ready to wait upon the Lord? When you wait upon the Lord, you're just like an eagle that has been renewed with strength. You are now weary, but you have strength from the Lord Jesus. Oh, we're going to wait on you, Lord. We're going to wait on you, God. Hallelujah. Sometimes you're questioning yourself and asking, Lord, how long, how long? And the Lord is saying, wait upon me. Hallelujah. You are going to be renewed. It is in your waiting season that you have a renewal within you to fight the battle that is in front of you. Hallelujah. In your renewal, that is when you can fight and you can stand strong and face whatever the enemy brings against you. Hallelujah. Wait on the Lord. Wait on the Lord. Wait on the Lord. This morning, for the things that you're rebuilding in our lives, for the things that you're bringing, oh Lord Father, back into life, we're going to wait on you, Lord, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. Lord, I pray and I come against every lie of the enemy that is whispering in the minds of the believer this morning. Lord Father, lies that say that they cannot do it, lies that said that you are done, lies that is saying that you are over. And this morning I pray in the name of Jesus, hallelujah, I pray for renewal in their bodies, in their mind, in their souls right now. Lord, I pray that they will, Lord, fly like eagles, hallelujah, no matter what storms come in their way. I pray in the name of Jesus that we will get victory, oh God, Father, because you have gone before us and you are there fighting for us, oh God. This morning we take strength and we draw strength from you, God. We cannot do things by ourselves, and we ask, oh God, that we might wait on you, Lord, that we might be renewed, Lord Father, new, oh Lord Father, refreshed in you every day, I pray, oh God. And this morning, together as a church, we submit our lives into your hands, oh God. We ask, oh God, that you would have your way in us, Lord. We thank you, oh Lord Father, for filling us. And I pray, oh Lord, even as we depart, I pray, oh Lord, that your presence would go before us. And Lord Father, we would not be drained out, oh God, but we would always be connected to the source. No matter what comes in our life, oh God, Father, we pray that we would take this commitment and make this commitment, oh Lord, to be connected to you all the days of our life, oh God. And I pray, oh Lord, you give us the strength. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Lord Father, for the healing that you have brought about in this place. We thank you for delivering your people, God. We thank you, Lord Father, for using your servant this morning to bring about the word. I pray that you would bless him and use him mightily in the days ahead. Lord Father, help him, I pray, in his education. Help him, strengthen him, I pray. Let your name alone be glorified in his life. Oh God, we give the church into your hands. Lord, I pray for those who couldn't make it and those who are traveling. Be with them, we pray. We thank you, O Lord, Father. Help us during this week, we pray, O God. Lord, we give our work, our schools, our colleges, whatever we have, whatever we do, O Lord, we ask that you be with us. Give us wisdom, give us knowledge, give us understanding. Help us, O Lord, to excel, O God, in the field that you have provided us, O Lord. Lord, I help us to be faithful and help us to be a blessing to the people around us, oh God. Be with your people, we pray. We bless them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. We thank you, Lord, Father, for answering our prayers. All glory and honor belongs to you. And the church said, amen, amen, amen. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of the Father, the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, may rest and abide with each one of us, both now and forevermore. Amen, amen, amen. God bless you, church. Take care. We'll see you all next week. Blessings.